Good morning to all those that are in the morning. Good afternoon to all those that are in the afternoon. And good evening to those that are in the evening. Depending on what time you are, I bring you cavalry greetings. Today we are here to consider a topic, prayerlessness, the seedbed of other sins. Prayerlessness, the seedbed of other sins. The truth is, when one is prayerless and one is struggling through prayerlessness, it breeds other sin into a person's life. And as a Christian that is on this journey to heaven, there is need for you to quickly tackle the prayerlessness that has crept in into the individual's life. But just in case you don't know that prayerlessness is a sin, I bring it to you today when this title was given that I should look into it. Prayerlessness, the seedbed of other sin. And I thank God that has helped in developing this message. I pray you remain blessed. Let us pray. Father, we have come to you today. This message has been under, should I say, developing the message for some days now, and here we are with this message. Thank you, Lord Jesus, because out of this message has given birth to and other messages on prayers. Father, as we bring this one before your people, I pray that you will take over the voice, the knowledge, and you will take over this message. And this message will minister life and light to all those you want the message to minister to. I pray you cover me with the blood of Jesus. You cover your people with the blood of Jesus. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, please watch over us and let your name be glorified in this message and in every aspect of our lives. And deal with prayerlessness in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today, I want you to know that in the life journey that we are sojourning in this world, we are not alone. This brings me to a song that says, I am not alone. I am not alone in this life journey. Jesus is with me. I am not alone. You are not alone. You are not alone in this life journey. Jesus is with you. You are not alone. You see, my friends, my brethren, in this life journey, you are not alone. And in order for Jesus to be with you, you cannot afford to be prayerless. You cannot allow the sin of prayerlessness to creep into your life, because prayer is the greatest untapped and misused resources of every Christian. Most Christians are not making use of these resources that God has provided for us. As a matter of fact, the world is really yet to know people that are really committed into prayer. You know, Charles Spurgeon is one of his quotes. The question that I have today is, are we going to remain in the state of prayerlessness? If you know that in your life you are going through the state of prayerlessness and you are not doing anything about it, well, I'm here to tell you by God's grace that you are committing sin, and it is true. Because it is not good as we are sojourning on this Christian path, in this part of this life on earth, you are supposed to remain prayerful. Prayerlessness is a sin because it is opposed to the purpose and plan of God for every individual's life. What God does in the world and what prayer does for us as individual, our life is to bring us together, is to merge us with God whenever we go to Him in prayer. As a matter of fact, Apostle James, he also wrote that we should pray for one another. The prayer of a righteous man has many effects. Take for instance, Elijah was a man just like us, and he prayed fervently. that there should be no rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, 3.5 years, there was no rain on top of the earth. You know, then he prayed again and heaven gave rain and the earth brought forth its fruit. You can see this in James chapter 5, verse 16 to 18. Prayerlessness in the life of a person proves that God is not the first in the individual's life. When God is not first in your life, then that is practically a sin. No one can serve two masters. You know, you cannot be prayerless and claim that you are still in God. That means you are not really sure of where you stand. For either you will either hate one or you will love the other. If you are claiming that because if you are claiming you love God and at the same time your life is not on this prayerful balance, then my question is, who exactly do you love? You know, that is why we can see that you cannot claim that you love two masters. You can either love one and then you hate the other, or you hate one and you leave the other. If you are truly devoted to God, then you will be devoted to prayer. And you are going to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, our prayer life must not be diminished as a Christian. You can see that in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. And then John also exhorts us also that as little children, we should pray. We should keep ourselves from all idols that is going to stop us from praying. You can check this out in 1 John chapter 5, verse 21. Actually, to be honest with you, my brethren, God demands from us is to be number one. And in order to communicate with God, because as a human being, when you want to ask God for something, you cannot fly up there and say, God, I'm here. And the only way to request something from God or to be nearer and closer to God is through prayer. That's why God demands to be number one in our life. Failure to spend regular time with God in prayer, it reveals to us as a Christian that he is not number one in our life. However, if we spend regular time with God in prayer, it proves that we are attempting to put God first in everything we do. Let's commit the day to the Lord before you set out in your daily activity. Do you know that a man that dropped his spiritual weapon of prayer has already dropped his soul? And that is the truth. If you drop your spiritual weapon of prayer, you've already opened yourself up to several attacks from the kingdom of darkness, because it is only through prayer that a shield and a covering can be over over the Christian life. Prayerlessness in the life of a person can make you to be using your fleshly weapons. You know, our flesh desires some comfortability, but when you pray, when you go outside of the desires of your fleshly desires, when you go outside of the needs that the flesh is desiring, you will find out that when it comes to the time where you really need to make use of your weapon, you are not going to use the fleshly weapon in dealing with issues and matter. You are going to use the spiritual weapon which the Lord has provided for us. Such a man that is prayerless is going to retire to using his own arms of flesh. And such a man will depend so strongly, you know, instead of them going to God and say, God, I need to think something out. God, what exactly are you telling me? How can I think this thing through? They are going to be thinking based on their human knowledge. Such a person is going to be fighting battle with the fleshly arrow, when Christ indeed has provided the spiritual arrow for us. Our weapon as we are Christian in this world is nothing but true prayer. Let us take a brief look at the event that happened between Jesus Christ and the disciples before Jesus' death. The disciples had asked Jesus, Lord, shall we smite with the sword? You see, that is using the fleshly weapon. Shall we smite with the sword? You can see that up in Luke chapter 22, verse 49. But due to Peter's impatience, you know, before Jesus would respond, he had already struck and sliced off the ears of one of the servants of the high priest. Now, this reveals to us the level of unbelief, which is one of fleshly weapons, unbelief. In Romans chapter 10, verse 14, that one says, how then shall they call on him whom they have not believed. If you are demonstrating prayerlessness, you are showing that you did not believe in God. If we knew for certain that when we ask God for something, we should, and we know that God is going to give it to us, is it not a thing that we should desire to pray for? Is it not a thing that we should spend time in prayer so that God will reveal to us what he wants us to know, and we will hear from God and our answers will be given to us? We will not have to struggle with any form of unbelief. But if we spend time in prayerlessness, then you will not be able to hear anything from God. And this at least will show, if you know, your degree of faith in God. Because if you have faith in God, you are going to demonstrate to him in praying to him always. Also, prayerlessness will make you to be found sleeping when the enemy is about to enter. Unfortunately, many Christians, they will not know when the enemy strike. It is because their guard has been let down. You know, imagine when a believer halts to pray and he or she is found sleeping. Prayerlessness will not allow you to wash and pray when you need to. Let us hear what the scripture had to tell us about washing and praying. It says in Matthew chapter 26 verse 41, and that says, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. As we can see, the devil is very cunning. Imagine Peter and the other apostles, they were sleeping when Jesus Christ categorically told them to wash and pray. Today, one of the strategies that the devil still uses to make believers to fall off the Christian faith is to make a believer to slide into sin. You know, when you are not being prayerful, it is easy for such a person to backslide, to make a, and then a sound Christian will become a lukewarm Christian. It is only through prayer that the Lord will be able to reveal things, deep and secret things unto you. And when the devil is watching out, you know, to slay you away from Christ or to snap you away from God, the true prayer, the Lord will reveal to you. After you've prayed, the Lord will reveal to you and speak to you in order for you to guard yourself. But when you are not being prayerful, then you are sleeping. You can look at my previous message that I've given this message before. It is titled The Betrayal of Apostle Peter. You know, if you want to hear the details of what Apostle Peter did, you know, and his act of prayerlessness, there's a message I had posted and I had ministered on titled The Betrayal of Apostle Peter. I mentioned there that when the time for Jesus draweth near, Jesus Christ had instructed Peter and his other disciples. Jesus Christ told them, wash and pray, that you do not enter into temptation. Wash and pray. But instead, they were sleeping. You will not be able to watch and pray. That is just the truth if you are exercising the heart of prayerlessness. And that person will truthfully be blindfolded to the truth that they ought to know before it happened. Also, another danger to prayerlessness is that prayerlessness is dangerous to the soul of the individual. Any individual that has prayerlessness, it is very dangerous to their soul. You know, it is through prayer that we can fight with the devil and overcome Satan's cunning devices that he has plotted against our life or against our family members' life. This is a negligence of a divine privilege that Christ has purchased for many Christians. When you are not being prayerful, you will not be able to know what will befall your, what is coming to happen to your husband. You know, there are some wives that it is through prayer that God will reveal to them, hey, tell your husband, you know, God may reveal something to them about their husband or about their child or about, you know, about a friend, you know, and it might be a wife, it might be husband that the Lord will reveal something to about the wife or about somebody. It might be parent that the Lord will reveal something to. It might be a friend. Well, however, what I'm trying to say is when you are being prayerful, you are not going to, you know, there will be no danger that will come to your soul unknowingly to you, because the Lord would have revealed this thing, this fact unto you. And you are not to neglect this divine privilege that God has purchased for us on the cross of Calvary. But sadly, there are too many Christians today that are guilty and of this great privilege. And Isaiah cried out saying, there is none that calleth upon thy name, that stirreth up himself to take hold of thee. You can see that in Isaiah chapter 64 verse 7. When Jesus went to the storm, suffered and died, now the veil of the temple was ripped in two. This signified that there would never again be anything keeping man from God's presence. When we come to him through Jesus Christ, not to spend regular, you know, when you go to the Lord and you really, really desire something of the Lord, it is beyond you just going and saying, oh, Father, I thank you for today. I worship you. I bless you. Thank you, Lord, blah, 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 blah. And then you are done with prayer. No, you need to understand that this is a divine privilege that God has purchased for us with such a great price, that he had died for us. And as a result of Jesus' death on the cross of Calvary, it helped us that when we keep on our faith, when you accept Christ on the cross of Calvary, when you keep on your faith, when you in prayers, the dangers that ought to, you know, terminate a soul or terminate one's life or your family members or something, the Lord will reveal it to you. This is one of the privilege of we saying that Christ had died for us, and of we saying that truly we are in the Lord. Also, prayerlessness can rob one of long expectation. There is nothing. I understand that sometimes when you pray and you pray and you pray and there is no answer, you know, there's tendency to be weak. There's tendency to want to give up. That's another message I'll be giving after this, the next time I come online. But not to divert from this message, prayerlessness can rob one of long expectation. You know, when you desire something from God, it is not a time for you to be tired. You know, I have been in these shoes and I'm still going through the shoes. But the truth is, it is not a time for you to be tired. It is not a time for you to give up. It is a time for you to keep praying and keep trusting the Lord. Don't let prayerlessness to rob you of your long expectation, the desire that you want from God. Let us look at 1 Samuel chapter 1 verse 27 for this. It says, for this child I prayed, and the Lord had given me my petition which I asked of him. Do you know that in this passage, Anna, the wife of Elkanah, had no child? This broke her heart and she longed for a baby boy. Anna and Elkanah journeyed to Shiloh to worship the Lord. She poured out her desperate soul to God in prayer. You know, she prayed for a son. She even made a vow that if God can grant her desires, she would give the son back to God. Do you know, my brethren, if Anna had stopped being praying about these desires, if she says that it's been a long time I've been praying, God is not answering my prayer, she wouldn't have known that her long expectation desire was about to be answered. So my brethren, I'm encouraging you today. Do you know that what I want you to learn from the story of Anna is this? Anna was not prayerless at all. She kept praying. She kept praying. She wouldn't have gotten the promised child named Samuel from God if she had stopped praying. Also, do you know that prayerlessness can tarnish your reputation, your image, even before God? That whenever you pray, and you know, when a time you spent in prayer, out of burnt sorrow, the angel of mercy is ready to answer your prayer. Maybe God sent an angel, hey, go and answer my son. Take this answer to my daughter. But because you have not been prayerful, your prayer life has not been consistent, the accuser of the brethren, you know, Satan or his court or whoever it is that has been injuring your prayer, is going to bring up excuses before the Lord. Why is it that this one time that this person pray, you want to answer their prayer? All this while, this individual has been prayerless. And then they will back it up with several Bibles, you know, Bible verses. Remember that Satan knows the Bible as well. So also the agents of darkness, they know the scripture as well. So you don't want anything to tarnish your image or to deny you of your promises when the angel of mercy and when the angel of victory is bringing down your blessing. Also, prayerlessness is a sin and it denies God's pleasure in your life. And that is just the honest truth. The wise man of the Old Testament, they wrote that the prayer of the upright is his delight. That is the truth. The Lord delights in your prayer. If you call yourself a true Christian, an upright person, you know, a righteous person, your prayer delights the Lord. And when you are being prayerless, then you are denying the Lord the pleasure that he should have with you. You can read Proverbs chapter 15, verse 8. Imagine that God enjoys when we pray. Besides all the benefits that we derive from praying, God also finds joy in our prayer. This is another reason why we should not stop praying, because it brings in the power of God into our life, you know. But when you stop praying, when you deny God the pleasure that He wants to have in fellowship with you, then you are defeating the power of God in your life, because he God Himself is a man of prayer. With Jesus is a man of prayer. The Apostle Peter could write, "I am ready for anything through Christ who strengthened me." That is to say, he is even ready to give himself up into prayer. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. My brethren, please, I want you to also know that prayerlessness will hinder you from worshiping God in accordance to His will for your life. If care is not taken, your condition will get so worse that you will derail farther and farther away from God. And before you know what happens, the person will be led astray from God completely. You know, if you are not careful, you will begin to demonstrate independence. You know, when you are far away and far away from God, you will begin to demonstrate independence. And Jesus said, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he shall bear much fruit. For apart from me, you shall do nothing." Without God, we cannot do anything. You can see this in John chapter 15, verse 5. Also, the psalmist says, "Unless the Lord build the house, the labor in vain that build it. Unless the Lord guard the city, the watchman keeps awake in vain." Psalm 127, verse 1. Not spending regular time with God in prayer demonstrates that we think we can handle things on our own. But spending regular time with God in prayer shows that we are completely dependent on Him. Apart from Jesus, I want you to know that we can do nothing. John chapter 15, verse 5. Also, prayerlessness will not allow you to see that God has called you to labor for Him. Because you will not be able to pray as our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ commanded us to. According to Luke chapter 10, verse 2, which says, "Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, and the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his field." If you are prayerless, how then will you be able to get this commission that the Lord wants to be done? Also, prayerlessness will keep you from being focused on God. When the hour comes for you to pass your test of faith in God, if you are prayerless, you will not be able to stand firm in the Lord. You will not be able to focus on Him. Your victory ahead will not be able to stand firm. Take, for instance, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. When it came to a time for Him to pass the test, Jesus had to focus on God. Luke chapter 6, verse 12, it says, "And it came to pass in those days that when he went out into a mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God." You see, Jesus was faced with important decision at the time, and due to never-ending demands of his time around that period, he needs to concentrate, to focus his attention on God. He needs to focus his relationship with God. You see, Jesus at this point cannot afford to be prayerless at all. He chose to pray all night. This is why we cannot afford to be prayerless as well. You know, you cannot afford to be prayerless, else it will keep you away from being focused on God. Also, prayerlessness will keep you away from getting to the next step of life. You know, when you need guidance and you want to know, what should I do, what should I not do? You know, when you are being prayerless, what will happen is that you will not receive the guidance from God. You know, when you are prayerless, how then can you focus on God in prayer? How can you be able to move forward in the next needed step that you need? This reveals our unwillingness. And when you are being prayerless, it also reveals your unwillingness to let God to work in your life. Because he will not be able to guide you in your next step. If God is not able to guide you in your next step, then that means you are unwilling to let God to work in your life. Luke chapter 22, verse 41 to 44, it says, he withdrew from them, his disciples, about a stone throw, and he knelt down and began to pray, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. Now an angel from heaven appeared to him, strengthening him, and being in agony, he was praying very, very fervently, and his sweat became like drop of blood falling down upon the ground. My brethren, as you can see, that Jesus, when he was in the flesh, he did not even want to go to the cross. He did not want to go to the cross. He knew the agony. But then again, he kept praying. He kept praying. You know, he said, Father, if thou be willing, you know, it's not my will, but let your will be done. He knew that it will be, he knew what it was going to be like. He knew what it was going to be like. You know, and he would not only face the physical. God, Jesus knew that he was not going to face just the physical and emotional pain of the cross, but he was going to face God's wrath and separation from the Father at that moment, because he was carrying sin, the load of sin of the world, which he does not sin, upon his shoulder, with whom he had experienced fellowship all through eternity past. You know, at that point, Jesus knew he had to wrestle with God in fervent prayer. And Jesus prayed fully. He surrendered himself fully to the will of God. It is in prayer that we can allow God to fix everything that is a mess in our life. It is in our personal prayer experiences that we often wrestle with God. Our will be broken and our will surrender to God's will. Also, my brethren, prayerlessness will lead you to unforgiveness, and that is the truth. I'm also telling you this point from my own personal experience. Prayerlessness will lead you to unforgiveness and will not allow you to have the grace to forgive others easily. I mean, when somebody hurt you so deeply and you have this terrible rage in you that is accompanied with vengeance and anger burning inside of you, how can you easily let go without being prayerful? You know, when I came back to Christ after my period of backsliding some years ago, I came back 2012. You know, when I came back to Christ, year 2012, in his mercy, you know, there were some people that it was not very easy to forgive. Actually, a particular person out of them all that I was struggling to forgive some people, to be honest with you. But through prayer, you know, when I kept praying, God, give me the grace to forgive these people. I will mention what they did to me. I will cry to God in prayer. God, this person did this. Sometimes I will cry. You know, I will say, God, I need the grace to forgive. I need the grace to forgive. I need the grace to forgive. And with time, God gave me the grace to forgive. And I know there are a lot of Christians or some Christians out there that it was through prayer they were able to receive the grace to forgive those that have offended them. You know, so if you are not being prayerful, or your life is in the state of prayerlessness, how then can you pray your way through and receive grace to forgive others? Do you sometimes hurt so terribly when somebody you trust so much hurts you? You know, when that rage of betrayal, when it fills you up, you want nothing deeply. You desire nothing deeply than to revenge. And your revenge usually accompanies with this revenge. We accompany with fierce rage and anger burning inside of you. You want your life to go as if, you know, you want nothing. You desire nothing. You just want this revenge. But in the case of you that of being prayerless, even when you claim to have forgiven them, you know, you just need to do at that point is to pray for grace to forgive those who offend you. Only then will you be able to forgive them truly. Only then will the Lord be able to give you this needed and manifest this grace in your life to forgive those that have hurt you. So you see, that's one of the reasons why you cannot afford to be prayerless. Also, prayerlessness, it leads to a grievous sin against the Holy Spirit. And that is nothing but the truth. Prayerlessness leads to a grievous sin against the Holy Spirit, who himself, the Bible says, who himself intercede for our sin with groans that words cannot express. Romans chapter 8 verse 26. Can we look to the scripture that points us to the Savior who is even more interceding for us? Hebrews 7 verse 25. And fail to see that he is calling us to join him in this priestly ministry of prayer. Prayer, when you are bonding with the Holy Spirit in prayer, it is a priestly ministry of prayer. But when you are not bonding with the Holy Spirit in prayer, then you can never be closer to the heart of the Father. You know, that's, and when you are not closer to the heart of the Father, how then can you be joined with the Holy Spirit in prayer? Also, prayerlessness will make you to fall into temptation easily. And that is another truth, my brethren. Prayerlessness will make you to fall into temptation easily. Take, for instance, when Jesus told Peter that, Peter, you are going to deny me, you know. But Peter said he would not. You know, Peter said, hey, Jesus, I'm not going to deny you. You know, he said it like with all confidence. Peter, really? With all confidence. You know, it's like Jesus is telling you, you are going to deny me. But it's like, Jesus, I won't deny you. You know, I'm also at this point referring to that, you know, one of my previous message titled The Betrayer of Apostle Peter. Please watch that clip. The Betrayer of Apostle Peter. We have a lot of lesson to learn from there. So, as I was saying, you know, that prayerlessness we make a person to fall into temptation easily. Easily, my brethren. Easily. You know, in the case of Peter, do you realize that he actually fell into temptation? It's not just one time that he denied Jesus. It's not just two times that he fell into that temptation. It is three times, back to back, that Peter fell into that temptation. So, my brethren, you really want to be careful. Do you realize that how he went? You can see this actually in Matthew chapter 26, verse 69 to 75. Matthew 26, verse 69. To 75, when Jesus came to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, he told his disciples, pray that you may not enter into temptation. Pray that you may not enter into temptation. Luke chapter 22, verse 40. Luke 22, verse 40. He then withdrew himself to pray alone. After praying a while, he returned to find them asleep, and he also said to them, which is, you know, what I said earlier, that, you know, prayerlessness can make one to go into sleeping, you know, if you will not be watchful and prayerful. You so, and Jesus, you know, he said, why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you will not enter into temptation. Get up and pray so that you will not enter into temptation. Luke 22 verse 46. You know, also in the Lord's Prayer, when you look at the Lord's Prayer, Jesus commanded us to pray. You can see that sentence that says, lead us not into temptation. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Matthew chapter 6, verse 13. Jesus commanded us to pray that we will not enter into temptation, that we will not be tempted. Finally, with my point, prayerlessness, it hinders revival in the life of an individual. In the life of a genuine Christian, if the Christian does not pray and the Christian is staying away from prayer, before you know it, the light of revival will begin to go down in such a person's life. Prayerlessness, it hinders revival. Just before the day of Pentecost, this all with one accord, they were devoted, they were together in prayers. You can see that in Acts chapter 1 verse 14. And 3,000 people were saved that day as a result of their devotion in prayer. Just prior to a lame man being healed and another 2,000 being saved, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the ninth hour, you know, the hour of prayer. You see, Acts chapter 3, verse 1, you can read that as well. After being threatened, you know, by the people not to preach or to teach in the name of Jesus, they went to their home company and they lifted up their soul. They lifted up their voices to God in one accord. You know, that's in Acts chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. And as a result of this, the place was shaken as they assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake, you know, they spoke the word of God with boldness. You can see that in Acts chapter 4, verse 31. As a result of praying, there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house that they were sitting, and there appeared unto them tongues, you know, of fire distributing upon each and every one of them, and they rested on, and they, you know, and after this revival, we can see fire that came from above rested on each one of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in diverse tongues, in different tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterances. You can see this in Acts chapter 2, verse 2 to 4. You see, that is why we cannot afford not to pray. We need prayer in order to receive revival, in order to receive the Holy Spirit, in order to usher and to do great things for the Lord. Peter, as we can see, he then preached, and those who had gathered were pierced to their heart, and those who had received this word were baptized also. And that day there were added unto them 3,000 souls to the church. You can read Acts chapter 2, verse 37, and Acts chapter 2, verse 41. Not praying in the life of an individual can hinder revival, but constant prayer will help us and usher us into revival. Finally, my brethren, to fail to pray, however, is a sin. If after this message you still let your life to remain prayerless, it is a sin. And sin can only be dealt with through confession, repentance, forgiveness, and cleansing. I'm not saying if you have given your life to Christ, I'm not saying you are a sinner. Yes, but if you are prayerless, then you have allowed the sin of prayerlessness into your life. So if you are a believer, if you are a child of God, you need to go before God and say, God, I have not been prayerful. Please, Lord, forgive me. You truly need to go to Lord for cleansing and ask the Lord to give you the grace to be fervent in prayer. If you are convicted today because of prayerlessness in your own life, and you are convinced that prayerlessness is a sin, then don't wait to confess it tomorrow. Don't wait till another time. Now is the time to be honest with God about the status of your prayer life. Repent right now and receive the grace of forgiveness of God, along with his cleansing from the spirit of prayerlessness, that God should cleanse you away from the spirit of prayerlessness. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19 to 22, it says, therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he inaugurates for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw nigh with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith. As I conclude this message, don't wait till tomorrow before you begin to be prayerful. Start now. Do it right now. And I pray the good Lord will bless you in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, we worship you, we honor you for this message. Thank you for letting us to be able to look at this message on prayerlessness, the seedbed of sin that brings back to other sins that you have made us to consider today. I pray as your people repent from the art of prayerlessness, I pray you forgive them. Take away the spirit of prayerlessness away from each and every one of your people, O Lord. Father, make us to be much prayerful, to be much devoted in our prayer life. We cover our prayer life. We beg you, Lord, in Jesus' name. We pray that you will heal, you will save the unsaved, O Lord. Anyone that has not given their life unto you, give them the grace to repent from their sin and give them the grace to sin no more and direct them to the right church to worship in the name of Jesus, where their faith in the Lord will grow in Jesus' name. Write our names, O Lord, in the book of life, O Lord, and at the rapture sound, that none of us will miss the rapture sound in Jesus' name. Keep us from sudden death, we plead, O Lord, and help us not to go to eternity unprepared. Help us that none will die and go to hell in the name of Jesus. Save your people, Lord, in Jesus' name. Father, I pray you will care for the fatherless, the motherless, the orphans, the widow, and all those that are looking up unto you for great and greater miracles in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer to our prayers. Pray for us, Lord. We are covered with the blood of Jesus. We will not fall into the ditch of the enemy. You will keep us from the arrows of the wicked ones and from the forces of darkness in your mercy. You will plead our cause, O Lord, and defend us from the accuser of the brethren. Pray for every one of us, Lord. We are covered with the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Thank you so very much, and God bless you. I thank God that we're able to cover this message in about 41 minutes thereabout. Stay blessed, and as always, till next time I come online, remain blessed. God bless you.